I didn't realize the music stopped on the countdown that early. So you guys have 10 seconds to stand. You can slowly stand up. Let's stand and worship together.
He became sin, who knew no sin, we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from hell. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, His blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Yeah. Jesus Messiah. Name above all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. All our hope is in you. name above all.
Every head bowed and every eye closed and every believer praying, shall we, as we get ready to worship through communion what we have just sung about. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, Jesus Lord of all. Tell him that as we pray. Tell him that as we pray this morning. Father, thank you for the time that we have to worship you today and the variety of ways that you've given that we can do that. Thank you for the truth we have just sung. And for the celebration of that truth through communion, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your willingness to go to the cross, to do all that could be done for the forgiveness of our sins, and today for the portrayal of that through the bread and through the cup. Thank you that we can enjoy this time together because of you. And so in this time of getting ready to observe that, and it's time to begin singing further and studying your word together and just spending this time in fellowship with you. We pray that your hand will be on us to make it happen in a way that will honor and magnify you. And we'll praise you and we'll thank you for that because we pray it in that name that's above all names. Amen. You may be seated. At least twice a month, we try to observe communion, and usually when I stand up here, I try to offer some thoughts about communion. As I've continued to study that since my earliest days of first being exposed to it, I've discovered that, boy, it's like peeling an onion. There's layers and layers and layers of truths that can be brought out and need to be brought out from time to time. But today, I just want us to say, let's keep it simple, can we? Let me read to you, first of all, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and read what the Apostle Paul said as he wrote this, and the inspiration of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And he wrote, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" A thought crossed my mind this week as I was preparing for this, and the thought was, is all the time Ginger and I have been at the doctor's office going through this thing with her heart surgery and so forth, because we've been in so many offices filling out so much paperwork. Well, she has. And I've just been sitting at her side. And since there's nothing really for me to do, I kind of study what's on people's desks and what's in their offices. You ever do that? You know, you see these pictures over here, and there's little whatnots on their desk and so forth. And what do we put in our offices? What do we put around us? It's those things, is it not, that are most important to us. You'll see pictures of family, you know, and you'll see little things. Some of the things we've seen were religious symbols that spoke of what their faith was and so forth and those kinds of things. And there's a lot of things that we could say about the Lord's Supper and so forth, but when the simplest message of all that we look at this passage that I just read moments ago, is that Jesus is most important of all. If he were just in our theoretical office this morning, hopefully it would be his picture, it would be his cross, it would be symbols of him surrounding us, because he's most important of all. And were it not for him, well, let's just pack up and go home today, right? But because of him, we're here to sing and to pray and to study the scriptures. And so as we take the bread and the drink today, we do that because he's most important of all. Amen. And we need that reminder, do we not? We need that reminder. So I'm going to ask the men if they would come forward, and we'll prepare to take the bread and the drink. On the night before his crucifixion, Jesus took bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he gave them the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." Lord, thank you for this ordinance which you established that helps us to get our focus back where it needs to be, upon you who is indeed Lord of all. It's in your precious name that we pray. Amen.
Let's stand again.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Good morning, everyone. You can have a seat. Thank you for joining us today to worship. We're glad that you're here. Hopefully when you came in, you got a bulletin. There's a few announcements in there. Just a couple to highlight. We're trying to start now to make everyone aware. We're going to have another congregational meeting on August 17th. It'll be a dinner here in the sanctuary. And it's going to be all about the possibility of building expansion, and all of the members will be voting on that. And so we certainly are hoping to have a robust turnout. This is something that the leaders, elders in the church, and also a building committee have been thinking about and working on for quite some time. And so we hope to see most of you there. Also, next week we're going to have baptism. It says in here, if anybody would like to be baptized, talk with Pastor Marvin, and we're going to have one Lucy Kelly getting baptized, so we're excited about that. Other things that we've got going on, we're excited. We have two new families that have recently become members. I don't see the Browns, Larry and Cynthia Brown. When you see them next time, we'll recognize them. But also, we are happy to have Jennifer and Doug Miller. If you'll say hi, they are now members. And so please say hello to them and have a chance to get to know them. They're really fine folks, and we're excited to have them be part of Grace Bible Church. So without further ado, you can stand back up, say hello to the folks around you, and we'll continue worshiping God.
Howdy, howdy.
worship together.
Come gaze upon your Savior. Behold your great high priest. Draw near in awe and wonder. His cross has spoken peace. Come rest from sin and striving. Find endless stores of grace. The heart that turns to Jesus is cleansed from every stain. Oh, how deep, how wide, how long. Oh, how vast the love of Jesus. Oh, how sure, how sweet, how strong. Oh, how vast his love for us.
So lift your eyes to Jesus. Arise from doubt and shame. His blood cries, it is finished. Our life is in his name.
Oh, how deep, how wide, how long. Oh, how vast the love of Jesus. Oh, how sure, how sweet, how strong. Oh, how vast his love for us.
Hold me back.
saves are his delight. Christ will be fast, precious in his holy sight. He will He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast, raised with him to endless life. He will hold me fast till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last, he will hold.
Come the wretch in you are divine.
This morning we'll be back in Hebrews chapter 9. If you want to go ahead and find your way there, Hebrews chapter 9. And let's bow and let's pray as we get ready to look at God's word this morning, shall we? Father, I thank you that you've given us another text to study and from which to glean truth. And this is something that, like all that we've studied before, is life-changing. It's life-challenging. And so I pray we'll be responsive to the truths you show us today. And help us to see this overall message of Hebrews that keeps coming up again and again of the superiority of Jesus, the superiority of Jesus. Pray that it wouldn't be something that we would just say those people needed to learn, but help us to practice it in our lives. And so today, show us things that we can learn because of what you taught them and how now it extends to us. And help us to give you the praise and the glory and the faith response to it that you desire to see, because we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. Well, I was thinking this week as we approach this passage of Scripture that many of us have fond memories of the buildings in which churches of which we were a part have worshipped. And probably for most of us, those buildings have been buildings that were specifically designed and built for the sake of gatherings like this today where we could sing praises to God and pray and hear the Word of God taught and so forth. But probably more than a few of us also have worshipped in some places that weren't built for that purpose, but we met there because that's where our church met, whether for a long time or a short time. One of the places that a church that I pastored met was in a high school. It's in a high school, and some of you have met in schools before, so you know there's lots of work involved in trying to conduct a church in a high school. Every week you have to have this great team of people who bring out the carpets and the cribs and the things for the children and the chairs and all the stuff that you need to do church in a high school. The one good thing I remembered about that particular one, though, was the school was a large high school, and so it let us use their theater as the place where we gathered to worship. And so there were curtains and stuff around there, and it kind of made you feel like you're on Broadway, you know, you're up there on the stage, and it was really nice. One of my earliest memories, though, in a church that I attended for a long time when I was a kid, was the church that met in a fire station for about a year. We started off with our own building. We had this nice white frame church building. It's probably 100 years old. It was really, really old. It was located at a T in the road at the bottom of a hill, and at the top of the hill, there was a tavern. And so you can imagine the shock we all felt when we came to church one Sunday morning and the walls were caved in and the roof had caved in and there was a car in our church. Some guy had had too much to drink and he failed to negotiate the turn. And so we had to find another place to meet, and so it turned out to be the fire station. And that was really exciting for a kid. I've preached a lot of little churches, and I've actually been an interim at churches that met in some strange places, so to speak. Some were refurbished trailers and double wides, gymnasiums, a hotel. Another church that I spoke at a number of times had purchased a health club to be their worship facility. And so you could see the handball courts and stuff off to one side the whole time that you're preaching. And so there were a lot of neat things like that. And some of you may remember the history of our church here, going way back, that we didn't always have this facility after it was burned down. And so for a while it met at the Kane Center, and then it met at the warehouse. And I still hear people talk about the interesting things that happened at the warehouse, because that's down there by the train tracks. And the preacher, they would say, would be preaching, and sometimes he'd have to stop until the train went by before he could resume his sermon, those types of things. By the grace of God, though, we have this, and it's a lovely facility and a great, great place for us to worship. Well, when I think of worship facilities, though, one of the greatest, if not the first great worship facility that we read about in the Scriptures was something that God gave to the people of Israel back in the Old Testament. After he had brought them out of slavery and was taking them on the route that would ultimately lead them to the Promised Land, and after giving them his law, his standards for how they were to live and how they were to worship and how they were to just experience life, also he gave them instructions for the building of a portable worship facility. It's more like a tent than it was like anything like this. And it was something that could be easily assembled and disassembled and reassembled, because it was something that they would take with them wherever they went on that route, the place where they would meet to worship God. Now, not by going inside like we're doing here, and we'll learn a little bit more about that in a few minutes, but that place was called the Tabernacle. It's called a tabernacle. And it was largely made out of cloth and wooden frames and so forth. And again, we'll get back to that in just a few moments. The people in Hebrews never saw that place because that was way before their time. That was 1,500 years back before their time, something their forefathers had experienced. But nevertheless, being people of the Old Testament, they still revered it because it was something God had given their forefathers as the place where he would meet with them and where service could be generated toward him. Well, as we go through the book of Hebrews, something that we've been studying all along and hopefully realizing if you've been here for more than one study, is that the theme of this book is the superiority of Jesus Christ. And the writer here is writing to people who came out of Jewish backgrounds, who revered things like the tabernacle. There were people who knew all about the law and the priesthood and the sacrifices and the holy days and special times of worship on their annual calendar. They knew all about those kinds of things. What they didn't often understand was that those things were not intended to be ends in themselves. Those were things that were a means to an end. Because on the one hand, while those things would teach them great truths about God, and they were physical realities, we've shared this before, God would take physical things to teach spiritual truths. He's done that throughout the scriptures. Takes things that we're familiar with and uses those to teach us things that we're not familiar with. So while on the one hand, he was teaching them those great spiritual truths, when we get finally to the New Testament, to the book of Hebrews, we realize that beyond just some spiritual truths, all of those things pointed to one fantastic, great, overarching spiritual truth, and that is that there's a Messiah coming. There's a Savior coming. And that all of those things, in some way or another, point to him. They all find some point of connection with the person of Jesus Christ. Today, we're going to see that it is the tabernacle that they still revered, still thought about, you know, highly because it was something from God. But today, we're going to see in chapter 9 that the writer here is going to say that tabernacle is an image of Jesus Christ and of his relationship with us. Now, something that people didn't know about, and this is going to come out in our passage here also, is these people knew about that earthly tabernacle because they'd read about it and they could picture it in their minds and they'd been told all kinds of things about it. They knew about that earthly tabernacle. The writer to Hebrews wants to introduce them to a heavenly tabernacle. Because in verse 9 of our passage in chapter 9, he's going to say that this earthly tabernacle was just a symbol for the present time. It was just a picture of something greater that they did not know about, and something that would be the place where Jesus Christ accomplished what the earthly tabernacle could only do in symbolic fashion. The earthly tabernacle and the priesthood could never save anybody, but Jesus in the heavenly tabernacle, well, he's the high priest there who does. And so there in a nutshell is something you're going to see as we go through this passage together. Well, let's look at chapter 9 of Hebrews. And the first thing we're going to do in the way I've outlined it here today is I want us to look backward, because that's what the author does. He's going to take us back to that earthly tabernacle, and he's going to refresh his readers' memories about some things they knew about that earthly tabernacle. And so let me read those verses first of all, and then we'll begin to take this section apart here little by little and see what we can grasp about it. Now, even the first covenant had regulations of divine worship and the earthly sanctuary. And once again, I have to just say, I know it's difficult. Seems like we're always jumping into the middle of a passage, right? Because all this stuff flows together that's been talked about in this book. For there was a tabernacle prepared, the outer one, the earthly one, the old one, in which were the lampstand and the table and the sacred bread. This is called the holy place. Behind the second veil, there was a tabernacle which is called the Holy of Holies, having a golden altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden jar holding the manna and Aaron's rod which budded and the tables of the covenant. And above it were the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. But of these things, we cannot now speak in detail. Well, he can't speak in detail, but I will a little bit, okay? Because we're not Jewish, and so we're not as familiar, perhaps, with that Old Testament tabernacle as these people automatically would have been. And so I thought I would add a little bit more to bring us up to, hopefully, where they were in terms of their understanding. Because when he speaks about the tabernacle, he's going to speak of just the tent structure itself. And I want to go outside of that, and let's look at the tabernacle complex, shall we call it. And so let's begin, first of all, by taking a quick look. If we can get my first slide up there. There we go. There's the tabernacle complex. And there's so much more about the tabernacle that can be learned, obviously, than what's written here. And if you're familiar at all with the Old Testament talking about the tabernacle and God's giving the instructions for how to build it and all of that, you know that you take a pretty good chunk of scripture out of that Old Testament that God gave to his people. In Exodus, it would start with chapter 25, and it's finally finished at Exodus chapter 40. And after that whole year of building this thing, finally God says, we're leaving the area of Mount Sinai, and we're on our way. But God said this had to be first, and that's really a great lesson to be learned first and foremost of all, is God says you're not ready to go until you have something that will remind you of me at the center of your life all the time. And so he gave him the instructions to build this thing. And the tabernacle itself, you can see, is kind of back there to the left, and that's the tent-like structure, and you can see some other pieces in front of it. I've got some more pictures here, so hopefully that will help us to see what all was there. So as we work our way along, the tabernacle itself, that structure back there, nope, not that one yet, okay, stay back there. But you see the structure, and you can see the smoke rising from it there and so forth, representing the fact that the glory of the Lord rested on this place, okay, back in the back part of this place. But we'll see a little bit later a picture that's going to show this. It's not very big, that tabernacle structure. It wasn't very big. It's about 45 feet long and about 15 feet wide and about 15 feet tall. And it's got a structure made of wood covered with gold that are in some bases that hold it upright, and got some rods through there that kind of hold the structure together, the frame. And then it's covered with four layers of garments, four layers of, just different kinds of garments that were put over this thing. If we could look inside of that, and we will in a few minutes, you're going to see that there's two compartments to that place, to that tabernacle. The first compartment that the priest would go into, if you entered it, you would enter it as we're looking at it there from the right to the left. First compartment, which is a little bigger, is called the holy place. The holy place. 30 feet by 15 feet, and priests could go in there and do their tasks. The last 15 feet by 15 feet is a place called the Holy of Holies. Separated from that outer first compartment by a special veil. And all the priests couldn't go in there. Only the high priest could go in there, and that once a year on the Day of Atonement, when he represented the people and sought for the people, in behalf of the people, the forgiveness of all the unconfessed sins from the previous year. And when he would reemerge, well, the slate essentially had been wiped clean, and all the people would rejoice, we're right with God again, and everything would be fine until the next year when the high priest had to go in there for a second time. There's other things you can notice about this as you look at the picture. You can see there's kind of a fence or a barrier around it, and that's cloth too, that's linen, and you can see the posts that hold it up and so forth, and every piece of this, and we can only hit on certain points as we go through this, every piece of this is important. It's not just something just to be there, but it's important. And that barrier around there is a great reminder, and the way the whole thing is constructed is a reminder that you don't just approach God flippantly. If you want to come before God, you need to think carefully about what you're doing. People at large were not supposed to get close to the tabernacle. The priests would do that. The people could only go as far as, and we'll see as you go through the front gate on the lower right here, and you go to the, it's not a gate really, it's a curtain, and you'll see there's an altar there, kind of a square looking thing. People could go that far with an animal to offer. And a priest would assist them in the offering of sacrifices that they needed to offer before God. But beyond that, then the priests could go. And then into the Holy of Holies, only the high priest could go at that one time during the year. And that high priest could only go in that place which was representative of God. And what all of this teaches together is we don't approach God flippantly. We better be really, really serious when we come before Almighty God. He's a holy God, and we're to treat him with holiness. We treat him with holiness. Well, nevertheless, that fence is put around there, and what's kind of interesting also with the fence is that, it's about 7.5 feet tall. The tabernacle's about 15 feet tall, and so wherever they were on the outside, they could always see God's place. God's place. That's God's place. And be reminded that that was God's place, where we have to deal with God. And so that's our just a basic look at the whole complex. In front of the tabernacle on the east side, and then it's lower right, now we go to the next slide if we can. There we go. That square box you kind of saw down there was is an altar, and this is that altar. The altar of burnt offering. And the way that thing is situated, by the way, is that the tabernacle is always mounted in a way so it's facing east. God has specified, said it has to be facing east. When God asks people to do things, he's very specific about what he wants done, the way he wants things done. It's placed to the east. The first thing you saw when you went inside that barrier was that altar of burnt offering. And this is where animals were sacrificed. And the one thing I didn't care about, the picture that I had before, and I really had trouble finding pictures that represented things the way I wanted to see them, is that there was always smoke coming off that altar, too. We saw the one coming off the back of the structure. But there were always, always, always animals being burned on that altar of sacrifice, because there were always sins that needed to be confessed, always sins that needed to be atoned for. And so animals would be sacrificed on that particular thing. Again, the structure is not terribly large, 7.5 feet by 7.5 feet by about 4.5 feet tall. And so it's not a huge thing. And if we could just picture for a moment how things functioned, I think what we would see is just, people lined up with their lambs and their goats and so forth. Unless I'd missed my guess, when Israel was at their best, there was a long line waiting because there was a lot of confession that needed to be done and a lot of animals that had to be sacrificed. Right behind that, the next thing we would see, go to the next slide, and couldn't find a really good picture of any of these things. And by the way, we don't have any pictures of these things in the Bible. These are artist conceptions, you understand? Okay, so these are the best that artists sometimes can do is they look at what the text says, and they said, this is what it seems to look like, and so forth. So anyway, after a priest came and offered something on that altar, a burnt offering, his next task before he himself went into the holy place inside the tabernacle was to stop at the wash basin, okay, the laver. It was also like the altar of burnt offering. It was made out of bronze, and it was filled with water. And he would go there, and he'd wash his hands and wash his feet. There's symbolism in all this. Symbolism. And I won't promise, and I won't for a moment claim to have nailed all of the symbolism that's involved here. But there's symbolism in all of this. We can't approach God without a sacrifice having been made for our sins, right? We have to have our sins paid for. Amen. You can see how this is already beginning to point to Jesus Christ, right? We have to have our sins paid for. And the priest couldn't go on in until he'd washed. What was the matter? Was he dirty? Well, yeah, in a manner of speaking, he was dirty spiritually still. And then walk on his life. And so before he went to serve God, again, there was great care taken to make sure that I come, like the psalmist said in Psalm 24:4, with clean hands and a pure heart. And so that extra step was there to remind him that I need to come before God with a right attitude and a right heart. Behind that, now we're ready to go where the Holy Spirit took the writer here in Hebrews chapter 9, because now the Holy Spirit, he's he's not, he wasn't going to take us through all that stuff that I just mentioned, but now he's ready to talk about just the tabernacle itself. And you can see there's a cutaway view of the tabernacle that you can see the altar of burnt offering there on the left, and then you can see the wash basin, the laver, and then you can see this cutaway, and you can see the two compartments there. You can see the larger compartment and the smaller compartment. The priests could go into the larger compartment to do their tasks, and only the high priest in the smaller compartment inside the tabernacle. And so let's take a look here. He talks about it in verse 2. There was the tabernacle was prepared, the outer one, the earthly one, the one that we have here. And he goes and he mentions five things, five different pieces of stuff, of furniture, might call it, or just things that were part of that place that is designed for priests to enter and to worship God and to represent people before God. And so let's let the Holy Spirit kind of be our guide here, okay, and let him take us on a tour as we go through the front, and that's going past the water, and now we're going through the curtain there that lets you into the tabernacle. Let's pretend you're a priest, okay, so you won't get zapped, because you couldn't go in there unless you were a priest and had a right to be there. But as we enter the compartment of the tabernacle, this place is called the Holy Place. If we look to our left, the first thing you're going to see that verse 2 tells us about is a lampstand. A lampstand, a golden lampstand. Everything, by the way, inside this, inside the tabernacle is gold. On the outside, there was bronze. We had bronze altar. We had a bronze place to wash your hands, bronze laver. But now you're in God's place. You're going into the place that God's designated for himself. And gold is the most expensive thing and the one thing that's worthy of deity. And the one thing then that is common to all the things that are in there. But to the left, immediately we have this thing, a lampstand. And, you know, many scholars kind of just kick around, what did this thing look like? Was it a menorah? You know, most of us kind of know what a menorah is, and there's other artist conceptions of what it might have looked like. We don't know. There's no picture given to us, and there's no really elaborate description of it in the scriptures. But the important part is that it was the light source inside of there, the only light source, and it had seven branches on it. It's not a candlestick, by the way. They didn't have candles, but on the top of those seven branches, there were these light bowls. There was a clay bowl, most likely, in which there was olive oil placed and a wick that came out of the spout that was trimmed, and these were kept burning all the time to provide light inside of there. Now, what's the significance of that? Is there any significance in that? Some would say, oh, no, it's just dark in there if you don't have, no. But it kind of reminds us, doesn't it, that Jesus one time said, I'm the light of the world? Yeah, that's what he said, and kind of rings a bell with me when I think of that, and kind of did the same for some other scholars who have studied this. But that was on the left, on the left. If we look across to the right, the next thing we see is we see a table. It's variously translated, the table of showbread, or the table of the bread of the presence, or, you know, it's translated different ways. It's also made of gold. It's not very tall, a little over 2 feet tall. It's about 3 feet long and about 18 inches wide, according to the dimensions given to us in the book of Exodus. And this was on the right-hand side, and I like this picture here because it has 12 loaves of bread on it. Not loaves like we think about it, but loaves like the Jewish people think about it, more like flattened-out frisbees, right? So I like this picture also because when we think about moving these things, as I mentioned earlier, this portable thing is going to have to be moved from place to place. And people didn't just walk up and grab onto it like moving furniture, right? There were rings in the sides of these things, and there were poles that were inserted in the rings, and they were carried by the poles because this was holy stuff. This was God's stuff. Every bit of it was a reminder of God and the holiness of God and making sure that we treat God as holy. Well, anyway, when you look at that table inside that holy place inside the tabernacle, these 12 loaves of bread would be replaced every 7 days, every week. 12 loaves, go in at the end of that time, take those off, put 12 more on there. and the priests would eat those loaves. And once again, you know, what does all that stand for? Well, I know you can go crazy with symbolism, and you can maybe see things that aren't there, and some of my books that I have definitely did that. But there are some reminders here. Why 12? Let's see, how many tribes were there in Israel? 12 of them, I think, right? Okay, 12 tribes, maybe a representative of that. But something that was attractive to me is the idea that there's no higher fellowship in ancient times with another person than to eat with them, sit down to a meal with them. You're in God's house, so to speak, when you're inside the tabernacle. And these priests would eat the bread, representing that we, Israel, are God's people. He's invited us on the basis of what he's done for us to table fellowship, highest level of fellowship that somebody can have with another person. And so just a thought there. See what we have next. What's our next picture? Oh, yes, okay. Next thing the Holy Spirit would show us on our tour is then we're heading towards the Holy of Holies, out of the holy place to the Holy of Holies. And before we get to the curtain that separates the two, you're going to have an altar that looks something like this. It's an incense altar. Not very big, about 3 feet tall and about 18 inches square. And it's called an incense altar because they burn incense on it. And one of the jobs of the priests every day was to keep the incense burning. Take fresh incense in there and make sure the incense is burning, and the place is always filled with the smoke of the incense. And what's the significance of all that? What's the significance of incense in Scripture? Well, there's a couple of things that come to mind here. I think of Revelation chapter 8 and verse 4, for example, where there's talk about incense before God, and the incense there is said to be the prayers of the saints. Incense is a connection with prayer in the Bible sometimes. So on the one hand, I'm thinking, boy, I need to pray, but as I'm thinking about this whole thing being God's place and as something that represents truths about God, I'm reminded of something that we've seen earlier about Jesus Christ being our high priest who makes intercession for us, who prays for us. All the way back to chapter 1 and verse 3. He's in at the right hand of God making intercession for us. And so just maybe, what we're seeing here is what does God, this God, in the person of his son Jesus Christ, do for us but intercede for us? There's another thought. Let me go down another road here real quick, though, as well. Because on that one day of the year that the high priest could go behind that curtain to where that room where is only God's room. You know, God's not in this outer part. He's in that next compartment behind the curtain. And on the Day of Atonement, when he went in there, he took incense in there. And it reminded me of something else. When God showed himself or revealed himself in any kind of visible form to his people, especially in the Old Testament, do you recall what he did? He put up a shield around himself in the form of smoke, because people otherwise would be consumed by his holiness, by his holy presence. Remember, Moses wanted to go see him one, said, Lord, show me your glory. And remember what God said to him? Can't look at me, Moses. You'll die. He said, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll stick you in a place on the rock here where you can't look at me. And when I go by, you'll be able to see the brilliance of my glory around you, but you cannot look at me. When Moses went up on the mountain to get the commandments of God, the Ten Commandments, if you remember, the people looked at it, and the scripture said from down below, it looked like fire and smoke everywhere. Smoke everywhere. Can't look at God and all his holiness and us and all of our sinfulness and survive. And so I just thought, well, maybe since the priest was also commanded to take incense behind that curtain on the Day of Atonement, maybe that place filled up with smoke because he would be reminded that you don't dare look upon a holy God as a sinful man unless you have something or someone who covers your sins so that you will not be consumed. Well, the Holy Spirit is still taking us on our tour here. So the next thing that is mentioned, and if we get one more picture, there we go. And anybody know what this is? Of course you do. This is what's called the Ark of the Covenant. And there's actually two things here, the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat. Okay, the Ark of the Covenant is the box below, and the lid on there with the two angelic beings, the two cherubim, is what's called the mercy seat, the mercy seat. That's all the furniture that's in the Holy of Holies. So if you were able to go in, if you were the high priest and you were able to go in there, this is what you'd see. And again, you see the poles in there because that's how you were to move this thing whenever you went from one place to another. There's some other things that we're told about this. Inside the box, it talks about some special things that are there that were parts of Israel's history and God's dealings with them. If we look down to verse 4, you know, it says that there was a jar of manna. Well, that was a big part of their history, wasn't it? How was God going to feed them, take care of them out in the desert? One of the things that people are worried about, how are we going to get food and water? Don't worry about it. God's got it covered. And all of a sudden, this stuff starts showing up on the ground. Manna, manna, manna. They didn't always like getting it, but it was a jar of that that reminded them. Aaron's rod, which budded, that actually comes out of the book of Numbers. Numbers chapter 16, there were some rabble-rousers in Israel that were rejecting Moses and Aaron as the leaders of the nation, as God's chosen leaders. And boy, there's this big, big debate going on, and boy, everybody was angry and so forth. And Moses, in his humility, goes to God and says, "What shall we do?" And God instructed him to take this rod of Aaron's and to put it alongside the rods of the rebel rousers and to wait overnight. And if you remember the story, the next day, Aaron's rod budded and produced live almonds and ripe almonds. And God had made his statement. The rebel rousers were wrong. My chosen ones are still the leaders I have chosen. And so that was in there. And the last couple of things that are talked about here are the tables of the covenant. What's that? Ah, the two tables of the Ten Commandments. So those three things were inside there, inside the box. Now, what about this lid, this mercy seat? Well, the angelic beings are there because angelic beings are often associated with God in Scripture. And you may remember cherubim in particular. God had placed cherubim at the gateway to the Garden of Eden to keep intruders that shouldn't be there out after Adam and Eve sinned. You see them again in Ezekiel. They're there with the appearance of God as God is coming, being carried in, so to speak, in a visual way, and cherubim are the angels who are there and so forth. And so, again, just by the looking at that, you're reminded, I am in a holy place. I'm in a place where I won't see God with my eyeballs, but I'll sure see everything around him. And that place was very special. The top of that box, the mercy seat, is very special. Because on that day when the high priest went in there, he would go actually several times. First of all, he'd have to go in with blood from a sacrifice for himself because he was a sinner. He'd come back out, and he would go back in again with some incense, maybe come back out. It's hard to keep track of how many times he went in, but at least two and maybe three or four times. And then the time would come that he would go in with blood from an animal to sacrifice for the sins of the people. And he would go in there, and he would smear that blood on top of that mercy seat. God, here's a sacrifice for the sins of these people. And everybody outside waited, all around people waited and waited. Please come back out. Please tell me that God's forgiven us. Please tell us that he has accepted that for the forgiveness of our sins. And so there was a great celebration when he came back out. God is not done with us. God has forgiven us. We're still his people. I know that's a lot of information, and I still got more to go. What's the most important thing? What is all of this telling you when you look at this structure? What is it that the people had missed that the writer of Hebrews calls to attention? What they had missed is that they were people before a holy God. And if you're going to approach him, you better approach him with reverence and respect and worship. Don't do it flippantly. come before him carefully, because he is a holy God and needs to be approached in that way. Reminded of what the psalmist said in Psalm 33:12, when he said, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." Here's the statement illustrated. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Every time something goes on down there, the declaration is being made, our God is the Lord. Our God is the Lord. Do we not maybe need more of that sometimes ourselves today as we come? Have we prepared when we come? See, there was a lot of preparation involved in going in there on the part of the priests and the people and the high priest. Have we prepared before we come to worship? We're going before a holy God. He's the same God. Same holiness. Same reverence is deserved. That's the message. That's the message. Well, that's the earthly tabernacle. I'm going to have to hurry now, then I can, I can't do that very well, but let me see what I can do here. Because after having us look backward to all of that, now he tells them, now why am I telling you this? Why am I telling you this? And the reason he's telling them this in the next few verses we'll see is because that was an old tabernacle that had a message for us. It's an old message. And the message, well, let me read the verses, and then we'll see two messages here. Now, when these things have been so prepared, the priests are continually entering the outer tabernacle, performing the divine worship. But in the second, only the high priest, that's into the inner compartment, enters once a year, not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the sins of the people committed in ignorance. By the way, don't rush past that. In the Old Testament, there was a distinction between sins of ignorance and sins that were deliberate. And under the Old Testament law, there was no sacrifice could be offered for sins that were deliberate, meaning that I know what God's law says, but I'm going to disobey it anyway. It's called literally in some of the Hebrew texts, the sin of the high hand. I don't care what you say. The sin of the high hand. But notice he mentions here the sins of ignorance. The Holy Spirit is signifying this, verse 8, that the way into the holy place has not yet been disclosed while the outer tabernacle is still standing, which is a symbol for the present time. Accordingly, both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make the worshiper perfect in conscience, since they relate only to food and drink and various washings, regulations for the body imposed until the time of Reformation. But, verse 11, the most important words in Scripture. We're going down this way, going down this way, going down this way, and it's looking bad, it's looking bad. But the other side of it is, when Christ appeared as high priest of the good things that came, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle. Let me take all those verses and squeeze them down into one idea here, two ideas. Idea number one, the old earthly tabernacle could do nothing for the forgiveness of our sins. It could only symbolize what one day would happen when the perfect high priest came. There was nothing any priest could do for the forgiveness of our sins. All the sacrifices that were ever offered, and this will come out even more forcefully later in Hebrews, the blood of goats and bulls cannot atone for sins. Only Jesus Christ can. Symbol. It's a symbol. It's a symbol of something that was to come. And that one who is to come is mentioned in verse 11. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. And with Jesus, something phenomenal happened when he was crucified. Matthew 27, 45 and followings really gives us some really incredible details about while Christ is out there hanging on the cross as he's breathing his last, some supernatural things just suddenly started happening. There was darkness, the scripture says, from noon till 3 o'clock till he died. Middle of the day. And suddenly it's pitch black everywhere. Darkness, darkness everywhere. And an earthquake, the scripture says. The verse says, the earth shook and the rocks were split. But then there was a third thing that happened. Oh, this is the exciting one. The veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom. Now, what is that veil? Well, it's not the veil of the tabernacle. This is now the temple, which has replaced the tabernacle. But what is the veil? It's the same veil. The veil that separates the outer place from the inner place, the inner compartment where only God is. And suddenly, where no one could go except the high priest, and then only briefly, it's been torn open. The way of access to God has been opened. The way of access to God has been opened. God has thrown the door open for all who want to know the gift of eternal life that comes through faith in his Son. And I put the last thing on here. I'll go ahead and mention it because it would be incomplete if I said, well, look backward and look upward and not say, look inward. Because the point of the passage is not just to give information, it is to call for a response. And the response is, okay, having heard all this, where is your heart? Where is your mind? In fact, the word that's used here, he talks about conscience. The old system could not make perfect a worshiper perfect in conscience in verse 9, but in verses 11 and following, Jesus Christ can. He can forgive. He can restore. He can renew. He can rebuild. He can make of us something brand new. Brand new. Let me give you one last thought before we close. I've gone too long, haven't I? Just something that I'm reminded of in this passage as well. John's gospel begins by talking about who Jesus is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God. And then you get down to verse 14, and you know he's talking about Jesus because he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelled among us. Dwelled among us. You know what that word dwelled really literally is? Tabernacled. It's the Greek word for tabernacled. Huh. Interesting, isn't it? Look at all this stuff about the tabernacle, and then when Jesus came, same terminology is used for what he came to earth to do. Tabernacled. Because of his love for you and me, and because of our need of a Savior. I would just close by asking, do you know him? Are you trusting in him? This passage is just telling the readers there, just as like it would tell us, make sure. Make sure. Let's bow together. Father, thank you today for an incredible passage of Scripture. Wow, just for the way that you have made clear all along the way, the truths about yourself and about the salvation we can have only by faith in you. And I pray now that you would just embed this as one more thing in our hearts that we can hang on to and as a challenge that is ever before us to walk with you and to live for you and to experience you and never to forget who we are. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying for us. We praise you. We thank you. In your wonderful name, amen.
Let's stand together. Right.
Let's bow together. Father, thank you today then for the time we've had to worship, and thank you for the portrayals that you give to us in so many ways of your love for us and the grace that you show to us and the message that you give to us that salvation is by grace through faith. And thank you for this picture from another era and primarily to another people. But let us, Lord, not overlook its message for us. And help us, I pray, then, to be people who would walk before you in holiness. And we'll praise you and we will thank you then. In Jesus' name, amen.